بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على أفضل المرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه الطيبين الطاهرين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهه قولي. وبعد، الله سبحانه وتعالى says in the Quran: ثم جعلناك على شريعة من الأمر فاتبعها ولا تتبع أهواء الذين لا يعلمون. All praise and all thanks be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that created mankind, created the universe to serve mankind, and created mankind for himself, created everything else to serve us, and created us to serve him. I ask him to enable me to speak in the best possible way. I ask him to open our hearts, the hearing channels of our hearts. Allahumma iftah masami' qalbi li dhikrik. To open the hearing channels of our hearts to the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this class something on the scales of good deeds on the day of judgment. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us through this class not only dispel misconceptions about our religion, but rather have ta'zeem for the shara of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To hold the sharia of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the lawgiver himself, to have awe and more respect, if you will, more awe for his orders and his commands. I start just a quick reflection, something that came to my head, a small story about the necessity of focusing when we come to a class in general, when we come to learn, our intent and our focus, something that we lack nowadays. Imam Malik one time was sitting, and Imam Malik giving a session, and people, scholars are sitting there, great scholars of great repute, people of fiqh and people of discipline, and there were some young people, 14, 15 years. I see maybe some young people here today. And one of them was sitting there, and as Imam Malik, and this is in Al-Madina, Masjid al-Nabawi in the Medina, and Imam Malik is explaining and teaching, and the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and all of the sudden, people sitting, they look outside, and lo and behold, there is an elephant passing by. And Medina, at that time, people never saw what, yani an elephant is something fictitious. They never saw it before. They never saw this creature before. It's like telling you that you look outside and there is a dragon, a T-Rex moving outside. Now, when that happened, everyone left. Everyone, what's this creature? Everybody left the session of Imam Malik. Everybody went outside. Imam Malik stayed still. And there was one student left. One student sitting there, 14, 15 years old. And Imam Malik told him, aren't you going to go see the elephant? And he told him, yeah, Imam, I came from Egypt all the way here to study about the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I did not come to see the elephant. This person is 14, 15 years old. Youth was different. Had an intent, focused on learning, resolve. This is Abdullah ibn Wahb. Abdullah ibn Wahb is one of the greatest scholars of the Maliki madhab. He's the one that carried the madhab of Imam Malik back to Egypt and North Africa. The one responsible for carrying this madhab to North Africa is Abdullah ibn Wahb, a great scholar. But that's how he started, focusing. When we attend a class, oftentimes something I advise myself before you, a mistake that I myself do, we attend to listen. This, I don't want, يعني, as we say, بَيْنَ مُسْتَمِعِينَ, like we're now listeners, we just attend, feed me. Where are we going to write? Are we going to take notes? Are we going to study it again? When was the last time I attended? Maybe I attended a class last week, but when was the last time I attended a class, wrote down, and reviewed the notes regularly? This is necessary. When we speak in general before starting this class, the necessity of jihad, mujahada, jihad. Yes, jihad in Islam, 14 different levels. Number one, level number one, the start. When we speak about jihad in nafs, even number one, jihad in ilm. Struggling to gain knowledge. Sometimes it's not easy. Sometimes the speaker is boring. In 5 minutes, 10 minutes, if he doesn't answer my question, I leave. We have to be able to discipline ourselves, to have a state of mujahada, that I take ilm regularly. Even if I don't find an answer, I don't stop. So, mujahada in ilm, and then in writing it down, in studying it, and in implementing it, and then in teaching it and telling others about it. and then to be patient over the consequences after. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to enable us here to have this niyyah, that this is just not, he's going to be telling us about all the misconceptions about Sharia so we can answer people outside and that's it and that's what we need from that class. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have a higher aim, a higher intent, really. So that some of us, some of the young guys here, maybe, yani I'm not Imam Malik, but maybe if you learn about this discipline, you can become like Abdullah ibn Wahb. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you can be that way. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens on your hand and resolves so many of the issues that we have nowadays. And also I will start with this request. On this journey to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, on this path, when we go on this path, aiming to purify our hearts, aiming to reach the source of beauty, the source of peace, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, changing ourselves so that we reflect His divine lights and His divine beauty to all the creation around us. Sometimes we miss a teacher. I feel it, sitting here with this topic in front of my hand, Sharia and all the misconceptions, and I know the questions that are, where are you, O Prophet of Allah? I miss you. And therefore scholars say, As-salatu ala al-Nabi hiya shaykh man la shaykh lah. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we come today just with this, I'm very happy. As-salatu ala al-Nabi. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. In a time that I do not have a murabbi, not only a sheikh, a scholar, someone that I can complain about my ailments. I'm an arrogant person. I can't get rid of self-admiration. Someone that takes me by the hand, a murabbi, like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and those who are on the path, when today we miss them so much. One of the things the scholar said, in that time increase the dose of as-salatu ala nabi, because this is the sheikh of the one who has no sheikh. So this is one I ask before I start. The second thing, when we see people oftentimes coming and attacking us, which is what's happening today. I think one reason why people are interested in this class is because Sharia is a hot topic today, because it's debated, because there is so much backlash against us. What can we do? A lesson that I start with before even addressing the topic, which we will go through shortly, something we learn from Imam Al-Ghazali. When we miss a teacher, when we miss someone that purifies us, Imam Al-Ghazali says that, and this is a great scholar, and he learned it experientially. One time, Imam Al-Ghazali was on a trip, gathering ilm, gathering knowledge, reading the outward and inward knowledge. Great scholar of Islam in so many disciplines. And reading, and back in the day, there is no photocopy, there is no print. So he wrote the books he needs. You sit and you study, and you have to write. And he sits and months writing down the books. And on the way back to his city, the caravan, there were thieves that attacked the caravan. So Imam Al-Ghazali said, you know what, take everything. Take anything, but please. Don't take the books. Don't take those books, please. Anything, the money, whatever, but not this. And he said, one of the thieves looked at him and he said, why? And he said, this is knowledge, this is my knowledge. I spent so much time gaining this. So this thief looked at Imam Al-Ghazali with tahakkum, making fun of him. He said, what kind of knowledge is this that you have that a person like me can steal from you? What kind of knowledge is this? What happened? Did Imam Al-Ghazali answer back? No. And this is the lesson I'm speaking about. Imam Al-Ghazali paused and he said, I realized Allah sent him to me. Allah sent him to me. There is a message there. You know what Imam Al-Ghazali did? From that moment on, Imam Al-Ghazali memorized everything. Every single book, you read it, you keep it in your memory. That thief became a means, a way for Imam Al-Ghazali to step towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَنْتَ مَعَ الْأَكْوَانِ مَا لَمْ تَشْهَدِ الْمُكَوِّنِ فَإِذَا شَهِدْتَهُ كَانَتِ الْأَكْوَانُ مَعَكَ. Ibn Ata' Allah al-Sakandari says, you are with the universe, meaning what? You rotate around it. You're a function of it. Somebody praises you, you're happy. Somebody insults you, you're angry. Somebody, you're a function of it. You get affected by it. It becomes a hindrance. As long as you see it, as long as you see the creation, he's insulting me. They're insulting Islam. They're insulting Sharia. I have to answer. As long as you see them this way, you are around them. You rotate around them. They control you. However, if you see the Creator, if you see the Creator in everything, in the thief, in the one insulting you, in the one praising you, every single thing in your life become a means to push you towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Imam Al-Ghazali gave us this rule. In the time that we miss a murabbi, someone that can help us against ourselves. He said, the best murabbi for us, very interesting, is your enemy. Look for your enemy. Look for those who hates you. Is there anybody who hates us nowadays? Are there anybody against? They are one of the best things for us. Why? An enemy. Imagine a person that really hates you. He would really be struggling to pinpoint your faults, and he will find them for you. So Imam al-Ghazali said, listen carefully to what they say. Not with just an attempt to defend yourself. No, open your hearts, because they are going to tell you actually about your faults. They are going to tell you about yourself. Benefit from them. Today I say the same thing. When we see people attacking the shara of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sharia, throwing misconceptions, if you look that way, we can benefit a lot from those people. They will tell us about things that maybe we are doing wrong. When they accuse, there are two ways to look at it. When they accuse Islam and many things, is a barbaric religion. The sharia is a barbaric, they say that. Astaghfirullah. Far from it. This is the deen of rahmah. Prophet Muhammad, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ. Sharia, and what is sharia? We're going to come to that. This word by itself is amazing. The meaning of the word is rahmah. But you wait. Is it true? Can it be true that what they say has a shade of truth? Not that the sharia is bad. Did I represent sharia? Are they telling me that I represented sharia in a harsh way? Am I a harsh person? I am a barbaric person. Am I a bloodthirsty person? Am I an angry person? When they tell us, sharia, Islam oppresses women. No, Islam does not oppress women. I'm sure about that. But wait a minute. Is there a shade of truth there? Is there? In our countries, in the Muslim countries, are women oppressed? Is that true? Maybe they're telling us about something that we are really doing, something that we need to work on. When they throw misconceptions about sharia, it oppresses freedom, it does this, and I find I don't know how to answer. What does that you know what that tells me? Jazakumullah khair, you just pinpointed for me. I didn't understand the essence of sharia. I don't know what it is. It's time for me to learn, therefore. It's time for me to increase my knowledge. When I have what we call as a shubha, you know what a shubha is? Something that confuses you. When you really don't know, you don't see clearly. Somebody throws an argument sometimes and you don't know how to answer and you're confused. I don't know the answer. Sometimes it can be in something I'm dealing with in my life, left or right, which decision? How can I handle it? And this I have to start with before going. Oftentimes, when we get a shubha, capital punishment in Islam is bloodthirsty. Let me go ask the sheikh, right? Let me go, sheikh, I want an answer for this question. Even if the sheikh answered that question, you know what will happen? Next day, they're going to throw another question. How about slavery in Islam? Really, slavery? Yeah, sheikh, what about slavery in Islam? You answer that question. Minority rights in Islam. You see what's going on? And on and on and on and on. Rather, this approach I warn against. I warn me and you that we are sitting here for intellectual stimulation, for a logical argument. Tell me how to answer them. This is my purpose. I'm being faced with my main purpose is I want to debate and answer those people outside. Give me the ammunition. No. If that's the case, I please reorient yourself and your niyyah again towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whenever something confronts us in life that even I don't know how to answer that. The biggest mistake we do, something they call a tadbir. Ibn Atta'il al-Sakandari has a marvelous book called the Tanweer fi Isqat al-Tadbir. Oftentimes, you face somebody told you something, slavery in Islam, no freedom, why don't you drink? Why do you lash the person who drinks? You know, many, many things. Why is a man can marry four women? Many things that they will throw at us. How do we react? I go to my mind. I don't know the answer. Let me think about it. Let me think. I can't find the answer. Let me go ask. This is not how scholars deal with shubuhat. This is wrong. Why? You're seeking to clear this misconception by yourself. I'm seeking to understand, Ya Allah, what is the wisdom behind this? What is the wisdom? Why, Ya Allah, did you make this legislation? O Prophet of Allah, why did you do this? I want to understand more. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, we know this verse, Ayatul Kursi. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyul qayyum, la ta'khudhuhu sinatun wa la nawm, lahu ma fis samawati wa ma fil ard. You know the ayah, right? من ذا الذي يشفع عنده إلا بإذني. You know, but it, how it ends. ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء. ولا يحيطون. This is the ولا يحيطون بشيء من علمه إلا بما شاء. They us with our science, with our intellect, with our mind. You, none of us can comprehend a شيء. Not about Allah. No, no, no. Nothing about His, something of His knowledge, except if He wills. Allah's telling me and you, there is nothing knowable to know that you have access to except that I permit. You try by yourself, you will never reach it. When I see that I do not know the answer, I do what the scholars did. I start by going to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala first. Ibn Taymiyyah used to do that. Ibn Taymiyyah, sometimes he confronted so many issues, and he, Ibn al-Qayyim tells us this about his sheikh, that whenever an issue confronts him and it's not clear, it is difficult, a mas'ala that's hard and he needs to think about it, he said, you know what Ibn Taymiyyah would do? Sit and think about it? He said, no. Not. He would go out to the desert and start praying and praying and praying and sujood and sujood and sujood, putting his face on the dust and begging of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, I don't know the answer, please help me, please show me, for the entire day. He returns back and the answer is clear. Before seeking answers with people, before seeking answers in class, make sure, and this is the sign, that you went to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Practical lesson here, and we'll start after this. Happened to me. One time in my life, there was a big decision in my life, really, something big, and I didn't know. And you know what? I'll tell you what it is without the answer this time, because we can discuss it here. Is it okay for me to take citizenship? Is it okay for me to, yani, becoming a US citizen? Of course, everyone here, yes. How do I know? Is it okay for me to leave Egypt and live the United States in the United States by my will? If I'm born here, that's something else. Is that okay? Yes. Is that your opinion or is that the scholarly opinion? And I said, you know what? I'm not sure. Let me check. I have to check. Although I might not like the answer. And I started to check. And the more I check, it gets, you know, different opinions, different things. How will I take citizenship? Is it okay for me to take the oath? Is it okay for me to say it's okay for me to fight in the army? All those questions. And it took me years actually. And I asked so many people. And you ask, and the answer sometimes is so confusing. Until I asked one person, and not a scholar, a righteous woman, an old righteous woman, righteous, connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not a scholar. And when I asked her, yani, please tell me about this, is it okay? You know what she told me? Yeah, I have your answer. And I said, please tell me what's the answer. And said, I'll tell you what, I know the answer here. Every night before Fajr, you wake up 1 hour. Pray tahajjud. And every time in sujood, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give you the answer. Do that for 2 weeks. That's the answer. Now what did I do? 1 hour every day before Fajr? No. That told me a lot about me. I was willing to travel. If she was to tell me travel to New York or Boston, there is a sheikh to ask, I would get the airplane ticket. I'll pay the money to find my answer. I'm willing to pay the money. I'm willing to travel. But I'm not willing to ask Allah. What does that say? I have a problem. It's not about the answer, isn't it? And that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept it hidden from me. Now, when I see something I don't understand, you know what is the meaning of it? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is exposing you to a need. You are not all knowledgeable. You live in uncertainty. Certainty is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is a need that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala puts in your life. A shubha, a question that I cannot answer. I don't know the answer. This is a need from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If I did this advice, if because of this question that I didn't know, I started going for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala while seeking, I'll ask the sheikh, I'll look on books, but I'll make sure that I'm balanced. While looking on books, asking the sheikh, I'm also regularly in dua. If I do that, whether I find the answer or not, it was good for me. It was good for me. It became a means for me to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's what Ibn Ata'illah al-Sakandari is saying. And that's the advice I give to myself and yourself. You, if wallahi, myself first before you. If you want to benefit from this class, there are some conditions, if not this class, any class, a khutbah, any class you take, do not go with this indulging in the means and the planning without supporting it with spiritual ibadat with it. Without begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make this of benefit to you. Without begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant the answer on the tongue of the person who's speaking. You can do that. You can. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-fattah. He's the one that opens. You know, the opener, al-fattah, it's his divine name. He opens everything that's closed. When I don't know the answer, it's closed. Allah is al-fattah. If he opens, I'll see it. And that's the point. That is how we walk to the answer. It is not only intellectual, as many of us think. This is not only intellectual. There is a difference between knowing something intellectually and seeing it. Imam al-Ghazali, the one that studied philosophy, studied ilm al-kalam, debates, and was master of all this. When one of his students at the end of his life, يعني, asked him, Ya Sheikh, give me an advice. You know what his advice was? Ayyuhal walad, my son, oh boy, intasir tara al-ajaib. My son, oh my boy, if you walk, if you were to take the journey, you would see wonders. You would see the answer, not here, you would see it. There is a big difference. Sometimes you see something, you know it is true. I might not be able to explain it to you, but even if you might argue with me and I lack logic. But you know what? Even if I cannot explain it and convince you, my certainty is unmoved because I see it. I know for a fact that this is right. And one quick example is Ramadan. Fasting Ramadan. Something we did, something we experienced, right? If somebody comes to us as Muslims and debate with us, fasting is bad. Fasting is oppressive. Fasting, doctors prove that you need to drink 5 gallons of water every day. And if you don't do that, you're going to get dehydrated. If you don't do that, it's you're going to get sick. It is bad for you. It is oppressive. Why does Allah want you to do that? What does Allah do with you fasting? That is so harsh from him. Astaghfirullah. All what he said is incorrect, but your heart is what? Maybe I don't know how to answer him, but what do you feel inside? What are you speaking about? Fasting is one of the best things I ever experienced. I look forward for the month of Ramadan. It is the best month of the year. Right? But how can I prove it? What I'm saying now, I experienced it because I fasted and I know the benefits of it. I pray Taraweeh in Ramadan. How can I pray with one juz in Ramadan? I increase my charity in Ramadan. I feel the blessings in Ramadan. I read the Quran in Ramadan so many times. I do dhikr in Ramadan. This is a month that I love. Because I experienced it. If you experience those meanings, no matter what he says, does not budge my heart because I saw it. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that this class, I intend that it's not only logical answers. It's for me and you to see things before explaining to others. This is our problem. I can't explain that which I do not know. I have to see it and know it and understand it and comprehend it first. And when it's clear for me, then I try to explain. If my words are not good enough, alhamdulillah, but at least I see it, I know it's true. But if I do not see it, if I do not know it, if I do not live it, how can I explain it? How can I call others to it? When we go and call others to Islam, it reminds me of this simple example. Wallahi, one time people asked me to speak about da'wah. And you know, it happened, UCI. Guys, maybe in UCI remember that. And what I did is, really, I got this big tray, you know, like a big tray covered. You know, like food, right? Candy, maybe not candy, maybe basbousa, maybe, you know, like nobody knows what's inside, right? And I placed it in front of everyone and said, please come help yourself. Everybody came, you know, Jazakum Allah khair, oh, that was so nice of you. They open it and it was dust and soil and bricks. And they said, I don't need to speak anymore. Why? He said, this is what we're doing. I'm inviting people to that which I do not have. I'm inviting people, telling them about how great Allah is, how about the beauty of Islam is, and I never even experienced it. And I don't know it myself. How can you invite someone to a house while you're homeless? How can you invite someone for dinner while I don't have something to eat myself? Before answering others, when others ask us questions and we do not know, let us be clear with ourselves. Let's try to understand it ourselves first before focusing on others. So please, do not focus on answering others in this class. Whatever we say here is for me. Not for, oh, I know someone to tell him this. Now I know how to answer back. It will come. But see it first. And without يعني further ado, I want to start a little bit يعني little bit technical here. When we say the word Sharia and the beauty of the language, the beauty, the word itself carries so many meanings that are sufficient to dispel so many misconceptions. What do you mean by Sharia? We don't want Sharia, people say that. Okay, do you know what Sharia means? It means Islamic law. Well, that's English language. What does the word Sharia mean, the meanings of it in Arabic? And that you can find in Lisan al-Arab, a book written يعني, by Ibn Manzur, who died like 711 Hijri. It has every single word in Arabic language and the meanings of it. And I recommend that you look up words like ilah, deen, ibadah, rabb, rushd, ghay, hawa, sharia, shar'. Look it up. The word itself sometimes explains. And I'll read for you and bear with me. Be patient on this type of knowledge. I'll read for you what he said, translate it, and then we'll draw some conclusions. He says the following. So ma'ana al-shar'a lughatan. The word sharia, shar'a, shar'a. Right? This is the root word. What does it mean in the language? Before we start, it means the following. Shari'atu wa shira'u wa mashra'a. Al-mawadi' allati yanhadir al-ma' minha. Wa shari' ay al-tariq. Wa shari'a fi kalam al-arab mashra'at al-ma' wa hiya mawrid al-shariba. التي يشرعها الناس فيشربون منها ويستقون والعرب لا تسميها شريعة حتى يكون الماء عدا لا انقطاع له وشرع إبله وشرعها أي أوردها شريعة الماء فشربت ولم يستق لها. Let's explain some beautiful words here. شريعة means the road. شارع ينون عربي is in the الشارع means the road, a way, a path. But that's not enough. If you say sharia equals a path, a road, a way, it's correct, but that's not enough. شرع in Arabic, it's the path that goes to a source of water, that goes to a destination of what does water represent? Life. It is a path leading to life. It is a path leading to water. It's sharia. But not only that. They do not, the Arabs will not call it this path, they won't call it Sharia unless that the water source at the end is inexhaustible. So it is not just a path leading to water, like a small well. The water source must be immense, inexhaustible, so easy to drink from. If that's the case, this path leading to this inexhaustible water source is called Sharia. Not only that. And Sharia is a source, is your way to life, is your way to water. It is, and if you continue, they tell you that the Arabs would say that he took his camels, right? He took his camels, أورده شريعة الماء فشربت. When you take the camels along this path to the source of water that's inexhaustible, so there is no need for you to يعني, bring water to them. And then the interesting part here is what? وَلَمْ يَسْتَقِ لَهَا. And then you leave the camels to drink themselves. You do not force them to drink. So let's put that in, rephrase it. Sharia, a path that you would take that leads you. And from the definition, it's a path that it is known and it is clear and it's obvious. It is not hidden. And it has been traversed by others. All this is in the meaning. And that will lead you to an inexhaustible source of water. In such a way that you're free to drink at your own will, nobody will force you to drink. لا إكراه في الدين. No forcing. We will show you the way to water, but you are the one to drink by yourself. Nobody forces you on anything. That's in the word. It's in the. That's just the word شرع means that. And then they tell you, from interesting, وفي المثل أهون السقي التشريع. The easiest way to drink is التشريع. And I'm using the word تشريع. What does that mean? Did you notice the word what? Easiest? Easiest. This path that leads to the water is the easiest way for you to reach the water. That's the characteristic. It's there may be two, three different paths to the same. شريعة is the path of greatest ease. does this remind us about something of our Sharia? It is supposed to be the path of ease, the easiest path to the water, the one with that you do not have to suffer from. Other paths, even if you reach, it's harder. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling you, this is the easiest way. And of course, by analogy, what is the source of water? What is the source of life? Allah Himself. This is the easiest way to me. This is the fastest way to me. I can show it to you, but you have to drink yourself. I'm not going to force. All this, all what we said, isn't just in the word. Sharia. And it continues, وَشَرَعَ أَيْ أَظْهَرْ وَالْأَبْوَابُ شَرِعَ أَيْ مَفْتُوحَ. Shara'a something means makes it apparent, clear. Al-abwab maftuha, you know, like when you say the doors are shari'a, means the doors are open. So this path is open, clear, apparent, not hidden, no deception in it. Wa-shawari'a min al-nujum, interesting. Al-shawari'a min al-nujum, you see the word shawari'a from the stars. It means the stars that are close to setting. Mean the word here, closeness and nearness. Closeness and nearness to the divine. In the word of the word shara means that you want to be close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This path leads to nearness and closeness. Shara, sharia. Wa ashra' al-shay, there is of course shira' al-safina. We know in our language when you say that the ship has a sail. The sail we call shira'. Why? You put it on top of the ship and it makes the ship sail. The concept of sailing and What does the shira' do? Wind comes, it blows in, and you know how you sail with ease and peace? You see the meaning? Sharia. You're going to sail on this path with ease. Put on your shira'. You're going to sail. I don't know if you're noticing the beauty of the Arabic language, the word. Just the word, sharia. And the other meaning, وَأَشْرَعَ الشَّيْءِ أَيْ رَفَعَهُ جِدًّا. When you say, أَشْرَعْتُ شَيْءٍ, I أَشْرَعْتُ something, it means I raised it to lofty heights. So Sharia is the path that would raise the human being to lofty heights. It's the path of upward, higher and higher. And that's in the Quran. For example, you'll find the verse, they say in Arabic language, al-hitanu shuru', when the fish are shuru', what does it mean that the fish are lifting their heads? They're raising their heads. You find that in the Quran. About Bani Israel, you know, on the Saturday when they're not commanded to fish. And on Saturday, the Quran says, تَأْتِيهُمْ حِيْتَنَهُمْ شُرَّعَ. On Saturday, the fish comes, شُرَّعَ. What does شُرَّعَ mean here? Sharia? It means what? Raising their heads. They're raising their heads. So the word Sharia involves to raise, to be raised. Final meaning of the word Sharia. They say, interesting, هَذَا رَجُلٌ شَرِيعَ. This is a man that's sharia. He has a heart full of bravery. Has a heart. You know what? English? Brave heart. You know the movie Braveheart? If I want to translate it, a sharia. Don't watch this movie, by the way. I'm not recommending it. Do not watch this movie. But that's the meaning of it. A heart. You have a heart. There is a heart, and the heart is present. That's sharia. This, I didn't start anything. All this is from the word. Now when I translate Sharia as Islamic law, that's very unfair. Very unfair to the word, right? And therefore, sometimes when somebody asks you, Islamic Sharia, one thing you can learn today, if you're being asked this, and I don't know how to answer him, one simple thing you learn from today, you say the following, wait a minute. Before answering you about Sharia and your concerns about Sharia, do you know what the meaning of the word is? Yes, it means Islamic law. Tell him, who said that? Where did you get that from? Who taught you that? Because whoever taught you that didn't teach you correctly. Right? And here is the meaning of the word. And when you do this, two things. The meaning of the word is like, oh, inspiring. Oh, listen. And the second thing, I place what in his head? I show him something. Those who are speaking about Sharia, they don't even know what the word means. They can't translate it properly. They can't. For example, Sharia means Islamic law. Wrong. Because there is the Sharia of Ibrahim, the Sharia of Musa, the Sharia, right? شَرَعَ لَكُمْ مِنَ الدِّينِ وَلِكُلٍ جَعَلْنَا شِرْعَةً وَمِنْهَاجًا. For every nation, for every nation of you, we made a Shira and a Minhaj. there is the Sharia, the Abrahamic Sharia, there is the Mosaic Sharia, and there is, so it's not only Sharia equals Islamic law. It's wrong. And it's very limited. Yes, from the meanings of Sharia is legislation, to legislate. Indeed. But you oppress the meaning when you just say it that way. So that's something we learn. Doing with this knowledge, I can use it to make people rethink. Rethink about their source of information, that it's inaccurate. Those so-claimed PhDs and doctors that speak about it, how did you miss this? How did you miss the meaning of the word Sharia in the Arabic language, which is in the Arabic textbooks, like Lisan al-Arab, which is everywhere? And then you dare sit there and speak and tell us about what Sharia is and why it's unjust. You didn't even study it. Right? So that's the first thing we learned, the word Sharia. Now, the interesting thing that I would follow with is the following. Sometimes we learn a lot about the word and the need for it from the opposite. You know, like if you want to understand light, sometimes it's good to understand darkness. What is the opposite of Shara? And the reason I'm going to stress this a little bit, because there is, by the way, how much time do we have? Time, how much? No. Hadr. So the opposite of it is very important. And the reason I'm going to stress this, because it answers one question for us that I think is very important. If I ask you, why do you need Sharia? You know, when you hear the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah ordered, why do you look at it and you have to... Many people, yani, they didn't think about it. But in their head, the reason I have to look at those commands is why? Lest Allah be angry. Yani, all their vision is, astaghfirullah, this is wrong, but they don't say it. As if astaghfirullah is not correct. Allah is this angry Lord that if I don't do what He does, He'll punish me. I can't take riba lest He punish me. I can't drink wine lest He punish me. You understand what I'm saying? Therefore, I need Sharia so I don't get punished, basically. And some people would say, I need Sharia to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that's it. As if there is no benefit to me in it. And I want to change this. Why as a Muslim, when I say the word Sharia, I say, yes, please, it's one of the best things ever. I can't live without it. Really, sincerely, I look forward for it. Why? When you know the opposite of it. The opposite of the word Shara is Hawa. Al-Hawa. And this is the verse we said. ثُمَّ جَعَلْنَاكَ عَلَى شَرِيعَةٍ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ فَاتَّبِعْهَا. And the word فَاتَّبِعْهَا. وَلَا تَتَّبِعْ أَهْوَاءَ الَّذِينَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ. And we made you on a Sharia. So follow it. Follow Sharia. And do not follow al-ahwa. Now when you look to the word hawa and you want to translate it in English, they would tell you desires, caprice. More accurate, intellectual bias. Intellectual opinion. The intellectual philosophical views that I hold in my life. My view, my opinion. That's the translation of it. As a matter of fact, again, if you go through the Arabic language and you find the root word of hawa, hawa means, for example, hawa means the air. Hawa, the opposite. Al-hawa is the person who has no heart, a coward. It's called al-hawa. Hawa min al-nas. Wa-hawa means saqata min a'la ila asfal. Is free fall. Like when I say hawa, you see the Arabic word, following my whims and my desire and my opinion. You know the meaning of it? You are... Sharia is raising. Hawa is, and you know what a fall, free fall is like? No reference. Al-mihwa is a pit that you cannot see the bottom of it. You keep falling and falling and falling and going down. Hawa rajul aymat. When we say a person, hawa, he died. It is death. This is lughatan, in language. Now, why is hawa dangerous? I want an example of that, an example that helps us relate to, yani, to a little bit. The example I'll quote for you, something we learn from the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we pass it quickly, but it has a very big lesson, and it illustrates the importance of shara. When you read about the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the condition of Arabia before him, you know the condition, the days of ignorance as we call him, and I quote for you two examples. There is one, and quickly. How did the Arabs before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, they had the Kaaba, right? Who built the Kaaba? Ibrahim alayhi salam, the father of Tawheed, right? Ismail alayhi salam. The people, those people around the Kaaba are the children of the Prophet. Oftentimes when we read the days of ignorance, we read as if those were ignorant people. Those were the children of Ismail alayhi salam. Do you understand what I'm saying? Those are the inheritors of Tawheed. Those were the people that were established on around the Kaaba about La ilaha illallah, the father of Tawheed. Those are the children of the father of Tawheed. And what happens? You go to the Kaaba and there are 360 idols. And here is another interesting thing. When you read, even in the Quran, how do they worship? The style of worship, they go around the Kaaba, and Quraysh invented this, that you cannot come with your clothes. Those are unclean. So if you come to the Kaaba, you need to put off your clothes. You understand what I'm speaking about? In the Kaaba, in the Haram. Can you imagine of all places, when people come to the masjid, they try to cover, yani have reverence for the masjid. In the Kaaba, and you put off all your clothes, and you're completely, and they're rotating around the Kaaba doing what? It was supposed to be what? Dua, dhikr. They're whistling and clapping. Whistling and clapping. That's what the Quran says. Muka'an wa tasdiya. That's what they're doing. This is one. So rituals became very strange. Number two, and I quote this quickly, how about dealings with each other? How were they? One example that's disturbing, and it's very disturbing. But I chose this because it illustrates the point. Aisha radiallahu anha explains on the day of ignorance the marital relations between a man and woman. How were they? They were of different types, she says. One type is the regular marriage that we have. Another type, and yani, it's amazing. It's, alhamdulillah that I'm not living in that time and I was not subjected to this. That a man would tell his wife, a man married to a wife, and he would tell his wife, why don't you go spend some time with this man over there? Spend time with him so that you can get a child from him. When you hear this, how do you feel? What? That is a man tells his wife, go and, yani, can you, it's bad. And then the other type, 10 men would come to a woman and she does not prevent herself from them and they all have relations with her. And if she is pregnant, she would call the 10 men and then she would assign the baby, this is your son. And of course, the other type are the people with the red flag, the woman with the red flag. Basically, if you want to do something, you go there, you pay them money. And when I'm saying those two examples, what come to your mind? Two things I want to stress on. What on earth happened? Don't envision those people as those were ignorant people that had no knowledge. I beg to differ with you. Those were people that are the children of Ibrahim and the children of Ismail. 1,000 years later, what happened? What? How did you change? This is the one, like, what went wrong here? Right? But the second meaning, which is really disturbing, is what? How don't you see that there is nothing wrong with this? The fact that they accept it, the fact that they see that it's okay, there is nothing wrong with it. That is more disturbing, isn't it? I don't know if you get what I'm saying. The fact that they don't see anything wrong with it, that as a matter of fact, if you argue with them, they would argue back. This is correct. I like it. This is the correct way. How on earth did that happen? This is hawa. This intellectual view that clouds that you do not see. So something that's tremendously ugly, tremendously unbelievable ugly, that destructive, you see it as good and nice. And you like it and you want it. Hawa. This is why it's very dangerous. And you cannot tell. When I read this, why is that serious for me as a Muslim? A true seeker to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his first thing that comes to his mind, oh my God, subhanallah, am I like that? Oftentimes we read this, oh yeah, that was in the days of ignorance, but nowadays, alhamdulillah, we're educated, it doesn't happen to us. Really? If it happened to the children of Ibrahim and Ismail, how do I know? Am I inclined? Are things that I see that are good, and I like them, and I don't. there is nothing wrong in them. Can I be in the same boat? They're actually bad. And things that I see as bad, are they good? How do I know? Where is my reference? I need a reference. What is right? What is wrong? Where is the reference? I'm afraid a true seeker to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first thing is the following, is that the first thing I need to get out of, I need to calibrate the instrument. This instrument by which I see things the way they are, may be uncalibrated, which is the heart. فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَ الْأَبْصَارِ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَ الْقُلُوبِ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ. They didn't see anything wrong with it. Today, just to bring it, the need of shara today, I'll give you a simple example about sharia and hawa today. How about dating? Let's take dating in the West and dating back in the East. In the Western countries, if you're a person that was, I happen to be born here, a person who's not a Muslim, and he's raised in this environment, he grows up, how does he see dating? Having a girlfriend. Actually, it is recommended. It is nice. As a matter of fact, what happens in Valentine's Day? How you take your girlfriend to your father, and your father, yeah, you're very nice, and you go out, and it's okay. They love each other, nothing wrong. And if you don't do that, what's wrong with you? Why not? And we call it love. And people, they don't see it as wrong. It is absolutely, that's very nice. It's encouraged. Right? If you take the same thing and I go back to a village in Cairo, in village in Egypt or Pakistan and tell people this. There are people in the United States that a girl will get a boy to her father. And she tells him, he's my boyfriend. And he would invite them to dinner and he would let them go out. And he would be what? You know what I'm speaking about. Unbelievable. Completely baffled, right? What kind of people are those? As a matter of fact, in his view, sometimes in the countryside, if you find your girl doing something wrong with a boy, oh, honor killing. Oh, my honor, right? And what do I have to do? This is that's ultimate shame. That is so horrible. That is so ugly. That is very punishable. And the punishment for this is death penalty. Okay, we have two views now. There are certain people that sees this act as, in their view, encouraged and nice and very nice. And there are other people that see this act as punishable by death. Which is the correct view? As a believer, as a Muslim, as a true seeker of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now I'm concerned. Why? I'm concerned about what? It is not what I like. Maybe what I like is wrong. Maybe what I like and love and see as good is actually wrong. Maybe the truth is not what I like. I'm interested, where is al-haq? Where is the truth? The reference. The difference between a believer and an unbeliever, a believer believes in a reference. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the reference of what's good and what's bad, of what is truth and what is falsehood, of what is beautiful and what is ugly. He's the reference. If I want to calibrate myself, that's my reference point. Al-haq. And maybe al-haq is not what I want. So as a true believer, I'm seeking what? Forget what I like and what I don't like. Where is the truth? Where is it? Show it to me. I beg of you. I need to find it. I'm afraid that if you leave me to myself, I might not see it. I might go astray. I might not reach the source of destination, the water. I don't know if you get the meaning. Now, this example, let's try to resolve it using modern day techniques. Democracy. Democracy, right? Okay, let's apply democracy. You go back in the Middle East or those countries. So, gather everyone in the village. What do you want? If we find a man and a woman together, you know, illegitimately, what is the punishment? Death penalty. All of us votes for it. What happens? You come here, democracy. All of us votes for what? It is okay. إِن تُطِعْ أَكْثَرَ مَنْ فِي الْأَرْضِ يُضِلُّوكَ عَنْ سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. If you were to obey most people on earth, they would misguide you on the path of Allah. Majority wins doesn't necessarily guide. Allah in the Quran teaches oppositely. If you were majority rules, you know what happens? Democracy is, it will reserve it. But a generation after a generation, you'll deteriorate. And you look in here in this country, you can see it happening. 50 years ago, how were the movies in this country? Remember, if you can make a research 1950, how the movies look like, 1960s, 1970s, and today, oh my God. What is acceptable today, back in the day, was out of the question. It took 50 years. They don't see anything wrong in it. It is unbelievable. This is a PG-13. You know what PG? Alhamdulillah, we still have yani, decency enough. We're still decent so that we'll put an age limit so that yani, children are shielded. Europe, they even don't have this decency. You open the TV and here it's in front of your face. They don't see what's wrong. That's where we're heading, by the way. 20 years, same. PG-13, don't watch a PG-13 movie. I remember long, long time ago, PG-13, and okay, PG-13 for kids, okay. Oh my God, what's in there? And tell you, no, I know those people are yani naked, but it's only the upper half. لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. This is not even PG-100. PG-13? What's wrong? And the actor sees it's okay. And the movie director sees it's okay. And the people watching sees it's okay. And worse, a father sitting with his kids watching together sees it's okay. What's wrong? That's what we're speaking. This is hawa. I don't see that it's wrong. I don't realize that it's wrong. A sadiq, a truthful person, starts by himself saying, oh my God, what if it was me? Maybe I am not calibrated. Maybe what I see as good is actually bad. Where is my reference? I want to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the first step is to come out of myself. And I finish, therefore, with the maqsad of sharia. One sentence. Therefore, scholars say, one of the intents of sharia, one reason for sharia, one main purpose of sharia, هي إخراج المكلف عن داعية هواه ليكون عبدا لمولاه. The purpose of sharia is, and look at the words, to free the servant of Allah, to free one of us from the yokes and chains of his hawa, so that he can become a true abd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Freedom. Sharia is not about, sharia is freedom. Freedom of me. Freedom of my desires. Freedom from my ailments. To be free from them. When we say, I want to be free, what do you mean? Free in language, hur, means to be pure. I want to be free. I want to be free, pure from defects. Do you want to be free from Allah? Do you want to be free of guidance? Do you want to be free of, what do you mean? Do you want to be free, meaning in space with nothing around you? You know what people, when they say, I want to be free, they refer to their caprice. I want to be free to eat, copulate, entertain as much as I want. I want to be free to use whatever I want. I want a license to do anything I want. It's an afsani freedom. It's a freedom of a cow. I want to be a super khinzir. That's the Quran, by the way, says that. The Quran puts the cattle nafs. There is a type of nufus, a nafs al-bahimiyya. And that's a freedom of that type. When I speak, I want to be free. Sharia is limiting me. Indeed, Sharia is limiting the things that pulls you down, down, down. It wants to raise you. It will limit things, but those things are things that are negative. So that you can be really free. An angelic freedom. Angelic freedom, and what is the difference? A bahimi freedom, a cattle-like freedom. I eat anything. I go have relations with anyone, anytime I want. No limitation. Is that angelic? Is that good? Is that, and why? Because that makes me happy. You find happiness in that? Is that the essence of a human being? Your true essence now, if you continue on this path and you continue this path, the reality of this human being is not just the cells. Your ruh, your qalb becomes really like an animal. Your nafs completely overwhelms your heart and you become a full bahimi, nafs, a cattle-like individual. Who's on the weekends and the weekdays, his purpose of life, what makes him happy, what makes him concerned are the things that make a cow happy and concerned. I don't want, a human being is more than that. Freedom is more than that. When we speak about freedom, the shara is to free us from this so that we would be free examples, because sometimes we lost. You know what freedom means for me? That I'm free to worship. That I feel free. If I tell you, why don't you pray for 2 hours? What do you feel? I can't. Something is shackling me down. I want to be free, brothers and sisters, in such a way that when you tell me pray, I can pray for 2 hours. I want to be free in such a way that when you tell me give charity, I give 50%. I want to be free in such a way that when somebody wrongs me, I find it easy to forgive. This is freedom. I want to be free like Urwa ibn Zubayr when he lost his kid, when he went to visit the Khalifa and horses were on top of his kid and the news came, you lost your kid. Your son died and all of a sudden his leg, he had a disease in it and they had to cut his leg. In one day he lost his son and his leg and nobody knew what to tell him. What are you going to tell him? How can you give him condolences? His son died and he lost one of his limbs. And he wakes up and he says, bring my limb, bring my leg. They bring it and he pats on it. He says, I make you witness that I never moved with my leg except in halal. And then he says, he looks to people, giving them advice. Alhamdulillah, Allah granted me 6 kids. He took 1 and he left me with 5. Alhamdulillah, Allah granted me 4 limbs. He kept 3 and took 1. Be thankful to Allah. That's freedom. Ibn Taymiyyah, when he went to prison. Prison is what? I don't want to go to prison. Prison is not freedom, right? And he goes to prison, and his student, Ibn al-Qayyim narrates this, goes in al-Wabil al-Sayyib, an excellent book about dhikr, al-Wabil al-Sayyib, min al-Kalim al-Tayyib, it's translated to English, highly recommended. He goes to visit him, and he, yani, to try to make him, yani, I have to tell him some words, and he says, we go to visit him, and all of a sudden, we find him in such a state of peace and ease, and tib aish, living such a life, to the extent that it was the opposite. When we are concerned, we used to go visit Ibn Taymiyyah in prison so that we would feel better. And then Ibn Taymiyyah looks to him, teaches him, tells him, Al-Mahboos, Al-Ma'soor man asarahu hawah, Al-Mahboos man hubisa qalbah. The one who's imprisoned is the one whose hawa imprisoned him. The one who's in jail is the one whose heart is in jail. ما يفعل أعدائي بي. What my enemies can do to me. جنتي في صدري. بستاني في صدري. أينما ذهبت فهو معي. What can they do to me? My paradise, my spring is in my heart. Wherever I go, I find it with me. What? This is freedom. This is the purpose of getting us out of the yokes of our hawa. Now, I'll stop here this time, but one important thing that we start with next time, we're going to go more in depth next time on Sharia about the concept of ittiba', following. Allah tells us, follow Sharia. Don't follow your caprice. Don't follow yourself. Don't follow your desires. فَخَلَفَ مِنْ بَعْدِهِمْ خَلْفٌ أَضَاعُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَاتَّبَعُوا الشَّهَوَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about people that came after Ibrahim and prophets. People came after them that lost the prayers and followed the تَبَعُوا الشَّهَوَاتِ, their desires. What path am I taking? What footsteps are on my path? The path of Sharia, when you look to the footsteps, it is the footsteps of Ibrahim. It's the footsteps of Maryam. It's the footsteps of Al-Junaid. It's the footsteps of Sheikh Abdul Qadir Al-Jilani. Salah al-Din, I'm happy. When you take the other path, whose footsteps are there? Where are you going? Where is it leading you? This one, I know where it's leading. Because I know what they are and what they were. I want to be on their destination. Following with intent. When we say follow, our problem is, and we'll discuss this next time, we tend to follow literally. We follow, basically our idea is the rules of Sharia are fixed, they never changed. Whatever Allah commands, I do. Whatever Allah forbids, I do not do. Whatever, and it is so literal. Is that the case? Sharia has to do with the Muslim fitrah, the human fitrah. And we will discuss this next time. The maqasid of Sharia. The intent of Sharia, the purpose of the lawgiver. The Sharia has intents. Following. How can you follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not only outwardly, which we do, inwardly? And that would explain for us so many things that we see. It would explain for us, why do we have hudud? Why do we punish? Why? What is the purpose behind that? Is there a purpose? Yes, there is. Can there be a shar'i rule that changes with time? It is possible. What are, inshallah, next time we go through the intents of Sharia. Maqsad al-Shari'ah. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. جزاكم الله خير. One quick thing, the references. I recommend two books. Ibn Ashur, very famous recent modern day scholar. مقاصد الشريعة. It's translated into English. It's very easy to read. The more يعني elaborate book is Imam Shatibi's work based on الموافقات والاعتصام in Arabic. It's translated into English. Both of them are good references. So if you're interested in مقاصد الشريعة, what is the purpose of lawgiver, higher intense and more recent issues, please get those two books. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك لا إله إلا أنت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك. جزاكم الله كل خير.